Good morning and a very warm welcome to the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item today is inquiry into Scottish Government's international work. This will be the committee's fourth panel on the topic, and this morning the committee will hear from Mark Majewski Anderson, Director of Research and Innovation, Glasgow Caledonian University; David Hope Jones, OBE, Chief Executive of Scotland-Malawi Partnership; and Lewis Ryder-Jones, Deputy Chief Executive, Scotland's International Development Alliance. Can I welcome you all to the meeting and thank you very much for providing the committee with your written submissions ahead of today. I'm going to move straight to questions, and I wonder if I might open with a question to Mr. Ryder-Jones. In your submissions, you state that the Scottish Parliament would scrutinise the Scottish Government's external affairs spending using a policy coherence for sustainable development approach. I just wonder if you could elaborate a little bit further and other examples of this in action elsewhere.
Sure. Good morning, committee. Thank you for having me this morning. My organisation has been focused on looking into how to achieve policy coherence for sustainable development for a number of years now. And it's become apparent that much of the work that's done by the Scottish Government out with the International Development Fund is an important part of our global footprint, whether in climate terms, in environmental terms, or in human impact terms. And because the International Development Fund is as limited in size as it is by comparison to other such funds in other countries around the world, the coherence factors become much, much, much more important to ensure that we get value for money for what we spend on international development. So coherence issues can delve into any other policy area domestically that can potentially consider the different elements of the ripple effects of decisions and actions that take place here in Scotland. That can include our trade and business activity. It can include, of course, our climate plans and our ambitions for net zero. It can also include Scottish Government spending on procurement and the supply chains that are involved in that. When it comes to policy coherence solutions, it's still our view that there's much work to be done. One of the most important parts from the perspective of those who work in this across the OECD, other international organisations and the UN, where the SDGs have a specific policy coherence target, is that actually it takes systems to be put in place by the institutions who provide scrutiny to ensure that coherence is at least recognised, or incoherences and trade-offs are recognised at political level. So one example would be that this committee is looking at external affairs, yet, in fact, perhaps it should be the remit of other committees to also include the international impact of domestic issues, whether it's rural affairs, climate or otherwise, in order to ensure that these kinds of trade-offs and policy coherence issues are considered. That's the first step. But beyond that, there's lots of more systemic parts to how to improve coherence within the Scottish context. The Parliament does have a critical role to play to ensure that we don't end up working in silos. When we talk about coherence, it's not about necessarily finding the perfect solution. It is a journey that we all go on to improve the efficiency on one hand, value for money, but also the impact that we have in sustainable development terms across economic, social and environmental issues. So I put it back to the Parliament to say that without genuine sustainable development impact assessment tools, such as the tool developed by SPICE during the last Parliament, being rolled out across all committees, then the Parliament can't really take on its scrutiny role properly to ensure that value for money is achieved across any area of policy when it comes to international impact. We know that the low-income countries of the world are very dependent on the outcomes in both trade and climate action of a rich country like Scotland, both in historical terms and in present day.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from members, and I can ask about Mr. Golden.
Thank you, Convener. And I think this is a question for the whole panel, but perhaps start with Lewis Ryder-Jones, if that's okay. In previous evidence, we heard from Oxfam that Scotland's credibility on climate justice is now in significant jeopardy, and these are Oxfam's words, due to it missing three successive annual emissions targets. I would just wonder what the panel's view is with respect to this topic, and we'll move to Lewis Ryder-Jones first.
So, I mean, on one level, the commitment coming out of COP26 to have a loss and damage fund created as part of the Climate Justice Fund within the Scottish Government's climate justice funding structure was a big move forward. And as we know, this was lauded internationally as an important step forward for recognising what climate justice is. It is about loss and damage. It is about recognising that Scotland's own climate action does not sit in isolation from the impacts, particularly on low-income countries, and more importantly, the historic impact of those actions. The domestic targets on climate action are vital for that. But what's more important when it comes to the international climate justice element is that we take further action, and we and the government should be lauded for their decision to increase the Climate Justice Fund and implement a loss and damage part to that. I don't think that we can separate the two, I agree, but the action must be happening on multiple directions in order to make progress here.
Can we move to Mr. Majewski Anderson and then to Mr. Hope Jones, please?
Yes, good morning. Thank you for inviting me here. Glasgow Caledonian University has a Centre for Climate Justice, which carries out research not just in the ODA compliant countries, but across the world, and particularly in Scotland. And I think that one thing I would say, reiterating what's already been said, but I would also add to that that I think the level of funding is one thing, but also the way it's directed. And I would urge ministers always to consider the research that's being carried out and to use the knowledge that we've developed in this area to ensure that there's a real impact in the field when these are being carried out. And that's both at a local and an international level. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hope Jones.
Thank you very much for the invitation to be a part of the conversation this morning. Good morning. There's nothing I would disagree in what Lewis and Mark have already said, and probably not a huge amount that I could add to this question. I certainly support everything that's been said on policy coherence, and I think this is a very helpful and pertinent example of that. When the President of Malawi was in Scotland for COP26 in November, he was not only the head of state of that country, he was also leading the LDC bloc, the Least Developed Countries bloc, and chairing SADC, the Southern African Development Community. And he used that platform and his voice to talk very passionately about where the richer countries, where the global north, are continuing to let down the global south, that what has been pledged is not being met. So 10 years ago, the $100 billion to support the transition to green economies in the global south is still not being met. It won't be met this year, it won't be met next year, and possibly might be met the year afterwards. So it is very, very important to ensure that our actions are living up to our words. And that's as important in mitigation as it is in adaptation. So I do think it's hugely important for Scotland to have a credible voice, for any country to have a credible voice in this area, that they are taking positive steps and that they are meeting their targets. I think there are very good examples of positive steps the Scottish Government has made in recent months and in recent years in this direction, but that's no reason to take the foot off the pedal. So I think it is important, with all humility, to be aware of where we have missed as well as where we have hit targets, and for us to recognise that we have a weaker voice where we have not met our pledges and our targets to date.
Thank you. Could I invite Mr. Cameron, please?
Thank you, Convener. My question is quite a broad one to all the witnesses in terms of the Scottish Government's international office network, which is predominantly in the EU and in North America. And I wonder if the witnesses think that we are, as a country, in the right place, in the right locations. We have nowhere, for instance, in Australia or New Zealand, nowhere in South America. And I just wonder if the witnesses had observations on that. And I asked that question, noting, of course, the long-standing commitment to Malawi. But I'd be fascinated to know what our witnesses thought about the location of our international effort. And if I could start with David Hope Jones, please.
It's a good question, and I should contextualise my answer by, as the Chief Executive of the Scotland-Malawi Partnership, it's perhaps unsurprising that that's my focus. I do think that it would strengthen the Scottish Government's work to look at the option of having a footprint on the ground in Malawi. But it's not an easy thing, and it needs to be done right. The Scottish Government is to be commended for the fact that since 2012, it has co-funded our sister network in Malawi, the equally unimaginatively named Malawi-Scotland Partnership. And they do the same as we do at this side, at that side. They coordinate, represent and support the many civic links between Malawi and Scotland. And again, I applaud successive Scottish governments for respecting the independence and autonomy and the value of engaging civic society in that way. So I think there is opportunity for the Scottish Government to meaningfully have a footprint, have a small office in Malawi, but it should not blur the distinction between the governmental and the non-governmental. It should not disempower what is already there as a Malawi-led civic enterprise coordinating the Malawian civic side, and nor should it confuse or complicate the fact that the government of Malawi, of course, determines policy in Malawi for that side. But I think the fundamental relationship between Scotland and Malawi isn't one of necessarily big numbers or corporate entities. It's of friendships. It's of human understanding. It's of dignified partnership. And being able to have, you know, maybe a civil servant or two in Malawi to develop those long-term relationships with the government of Malawi and with civic society in Malawi, I think probably would help things. But it would be a very different sort of approach to what's happening in Washington and elsewhere, because it's not about trying to have Scotland's influence. It's not necessarily about building trading relationships, but it's about depth of understanding and strength of relationship.
And Lewis Ryder-Jones, please.
Yes, thanks. I think the answer to that question from the perspective of the organisation I work from is, unsurprisingly, that countries you mentioned in your question don't factor into the thinking of the organisations that I represent. Our membership contains around 200 organisations working across about 100 countries. Almost all of those are what we would term Global South countries, UN-determined low to lower middle-income countries, predominantly in the Global South. And I think that will then frame the answer I'm about to give you. The reality is that Scotland's economic development over the centuries has benefited and exploited global inequalities from the slave trade era onwards. And we must recognise that, and we must be very honest about that with ourselves and about what we want from our international relationships as a small sub-state actor. I firmly believe, and I think this is reflected in the views of our member organisations across the world, that solidarity with the world's most marginalised is more important than anything else at a time when we know global inequalities are rising and the challenges we face as a planet are getting worse. Without a reduction in those global inequalities, without understanding, as David Hope Jones said, the identities and cultures of the people in these parts of the world that we perhaps don't gain from in an economic sense, I don't believe that we can make genuine progress with action. So if there were to be more offices across the world from a government perspective, and I firmly agree that that's a very different thing to having civil society actors within those settings, I firmly believe that we would be in a better position to consider investing more in the areas of the world that are currently considered lower to middle income, where progress can be made in understanding and cultural ties can be extended and increased. That said, I do not believe that that should necessarily be a government office, and I think civil society investment is a much more powerful expression of that kind of development.
Thank you. And finally, Professor Mark Miewski-Anderson.
Yeah, I think I would kind of echo Lewis's last point. I think there's a real tension between depth and breadth of international relations. And I think there's some that would argue that the whole question of prioritizing certain regions and then neglecting others is not desirable. But on the other hand, it's not practical if you want a real depth of relationship. And I think the solution to this is to use civic society organizations, also universities, to help in terms of gaining a footprint within the different countries across the world. Our university has extensive networks within Latin America, not just with universities, but with governments and civic society organizations. So what I would urge Scottish Government to do is to use these organizations, find to map where we have a presence within countries and what that presence looks like, and then to take advantage of it to ensure that we have more of a foothold, and then to be able to make an informed decision about how much potential for investment there may be in the future. I think the rhetoric is very often about Scottish Government helping to facilitate international engagement, and I think we could split that and talk about how universities might help Scottish Government to engage more deeply with countries in other regions.
Thank you. Could I invite questions from Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you very much. Returning to this issue of policy coherence and what we all understand it to mean, I know that we've talked, or I think many people in the Parliament and the Government and elsewhere have talked in the past about trying to mainstream an interest in and involvement in the kind of work that the International Development Department and the Government is doing across all parts of government and the public sector. So I thought I might ask David Hope-Jones first where he thinks we've reached on that agenda, whether it's in terms of practical things like how we make use or how we distribute surplus equipment, or how we involve different areas of government in this enterprise, or in terms of in terms more broadly of awareness in different parts of government and the public sector of the importance of work in Malawi and elsewhere. So I wonder if we could go first of all to David Hope-Jones for a take on that, and then to Lewis Ryder-Jones, please.
Grant, thank you very much, Dr. Allen. Absolutely, as I said, you know, we stand behind the concept of policy coherence for development. And I think there are very helpful examples in the relationship between Scotland and Malawi to that effect. You look at for example, what Scottish Water has done with Malawi. You look at what the Scottish Police Force has done with Malawi. You look at what the sort of the health side of things has done with Malawi. And what I would say is, I think that the reason the Scotland-Malawi bilateral relationship is a particularly fertile ground for these sort of, you know, cross-cutting links with Malawi is the extent of civic support and civic buy-in. Very often when you look at, you know, why has this happened? Why has this developed? It's often not for some sort of top-down strategic reason, but it's because sometimes the officials or the politicians, the government ministers involved have their own connections, have their own interests in Malawi. Maybe they've been to Malawi, maybe they've seen the impact, maybe their mum's church link or their child's school link has exposed them to it. And they begin to think, what are the opportunities in my workplace to be able to be involved? And so it's grown up quite organically, I would say, rather than strategically. And I don't mean that in any way as a criticism. But certainly what we are seeing is a range of different interactions between Scotland and Malawi across a broad number of different areas within the Scottish government, but also, of course, across civic society and across Parliament as well. And our mission as the national network is to try and bring together these sort of myriad different links that have organically grown to be able to offer maximum strategic impact by ensuring that they're building on the learning of others and making a meaningful contribution to the plans and priorities of the government of Malawi. So there certainly are a good number of cross-cutting examples. I would encourage other areas within the Scottish government to look at what can be done. And there's an essential job while these organically develop to try and coordinate to bring together and have a single touch point then with Malawi to ensure we're really listening to those priorities from Malawi. Thank you.
And Lewis Ryder-Jones, are you able to say anything from the government point of view? Are you able to evidence some of this activity?
Well, I mean, I think there was two parts of the question there, wasn't there? Is how do we define it, and also are there examples of activity? I mean, I think, to be frank, I don't think transfers of equipment from the NHS is policy coherence. I think that's not defined as an action. It is perhaps part of the beyond aid agenda as defined by the Scottish Government, but these two are separate things. When we talk about policy coherence from the perspective of the research that we've been doing over the last few years, we're talking about something very unsexy, very uninteresting and very boring. It's about process, and it's actually it's an uncomfortable process for ministers and government officials, because what it is, it's about recognising where we could perhaps act in our own self-interest or in the interest of others. It's about accepting that sometimes that self-interest has to come first in order to represent the constituents that a particular MSP might represent. And I would give an example, perhaps subsidising a particular company that might have a negative international impact. I remember reading relatively recently about one such company in Fife. Now, the reality is that choosing domestic jobs over international impact is part of an uncomfortable conversation that processes around policy coherence would force us into. And I think that's where we come from when we talk about policy coherence. So
I suppose my example about hospital equipment was not meant to cover the whole breadth of policy coherence, but you make a very fair point. But I suppose what I'm driving at is, are other parts of government, are they becoming more aware of the very important issues you've just mentioned? And is it possible to ensure that these ideas are not completely corralled within your own department? I suppose that's where I'm driving at.
Yes. Okay. And I think that's and remains the biggest challenge of all of this. It's inherently difficult to stop silo thinking within any department of government. It's natural, and in many ways, I don't think we've made enough progress. I think we're coming to the end of the early stages of some research in advance of what we hope will be a wellbeing and sustainable development bill coming to Parliament that was in the SNP manifesto along with others, also in this year's programme for government, not in the legislative programme, I might add, so we don't expect it this year. Yet that piece of legislation and the research we're driving to try and influence that legislation is really trying to give us a base of understanding of where other departments have got to with their journey to policy coherence. And unfortunately, the reality is right now is it is quite low. You know, the examples are 2 years ago, I worked on a document called Policy Making, Outcomes-Based Policy Making, that was in creation with an EU-funded project called Bridge 47. The National Performance Framework team within the Scottish Executive supported the creation of this document to try and improve the understanding of how the national performance framework outcomes can be seen through a holistic policy coherence lens. As far as I understand it, that document and toolkit is not widely used within government. These are examples of where, if we want genuine action on policy coherence, that we must find a way to ensure the civil servants supporting policy making and the ministers in charge are using that lens to make progress. The other example might be the the Ministerial Working Group on Policy Coherence, we were really glad to see that that kicked off last year, and we understand that that will continue. That conversation that can take place within the ministerial setup in order to talk through these trade-offs and incoherences is a big part of it, but it's not the only part. These are cogs in a bigger machine that we must try and ensure are systematically undertaken.
Thank you. Can I ask, firstly, David Hope Jones, about how our understanding of climate justice in, well, if you wish, specifically in Malawi, has developed post COP and also post our the review that there has been of international development policy in Scotland. Again, that might be something that Lewis Ryder Jones wants to come back on to as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, the first point I would make is, you know, climate change, the climate crisis, is not an abstract proposition in Malawi. It's not something that can be debated. It is that the reality of life, rains are arriving later. Generally, they're harder to predict. When they arrive, they're much harder. The lake level is going up and down. For a country which is overwhelmingly subsistence farmers, these changes have a real material humanitarian impact. We're speaking today in what Malawi calls its hungry season. And so it's very important when we discuss these things, we recognize the immediate human impact of what we're talking about. And of course, that concept of climate justice, of those countries that are suffering the most, like Malawi, contributing the least, is hugely important, is hugely relevant in Malawi. Fewer than 10% of Malawians have access to grid electricity. The overwhelming majority of electricity in Malawi is from renewable sources, hydro in the Shiri River. And yet this is a country potentially being destroyed by the climate crisis. And that's why it's absolutely critical, as I said earlier on, to listen to President Chukwuera and others and what they said throughout COP26. And they were very clear that there needs to be a greater focus on justice, and that promises and pledges cannot be re-announced year after year, decade after decade, without real and material progress. We can only be judged on what we've achieved in the last year, not what we promised to do in the next 50 years or so. But I think there are good good steps being made. I very much welcome that the Scottish Government's announcement that they will significantly increase, I think triple, the Climate Justice Fund. I very much welcome the announcement for the Renewables Centre of Expertise. And I think that the position that we're in now is really trying to nail down what's behind those announcements. What does that mean? What does that look like? And critically, through this process, we need to be listening really well to our colleagues in Malawi. What do they need? What is most relevant? And we need to take those big policy announcements out of the headlines and down to the details. And it's listening to Malawi, I would argue, is the single most important thing we need to do in the next few months. And we need to ensure by the time Scotland is represented in whatever form in COP27, we've delivered against what we promised at COP26. Because this has already been said, there is a credibility deficit if we don't. Thank you.
And can I ask in that case for any comment on that from Lewis Ryder Jones? I had the privilege a few years ago on behalf of the government of being in Malawi, and certainly people spoke to me about the issues that David's just mentioned there, and the fact that they could see the climate and the landscape changing around them radically and dramatically. And while I don't think anyone expects Scotland on its own to be able to put that right, I wonder if you could say something maybe a bit about, specifically about Malawi, and how we were working for, how Scotland is working for, or what it's doing for climate justice issues there.
My own organisation's interest goes much beyond Malawi, Dr. Allen. So if it's okay, I'll give a broader answer to that question. For the organisations that work in the 100 or so countries that we represent, climate justice came out as a strong, if not the strongest, driver for action on COP in any setting. We worked with organisations to try and understand what that meant through a collection of personal and human impact stories on what climate justice really means in different settings. And the reality is it means a lot of different things. It means social justice, it means gender justice, it means intergenerational justice. And the reality is in countless settings across the world, globally, we're failing. And COP26 failed to deliver on climate justice. That's a sad reality. Yes, there was increases and a welcome commitment to loss and damage, but globally we're still far short of what needs to be done. Scotland is and has become a beacon of example on particularly loss and damage, but there are other areas that we can step up and join beyond fossil fuels as an example. The stories on climate justice that came out of our work pre-COP were wide and far. It wasn't just about damage from changing weather patterns, but it was also about risks to food supplies. It was about challenges for education outcomes and particularly impacting women and girls across Global South countries. Those messages were what came out strongest for us in our work.
Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Ruskell, please?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. And I feel some of the comments there about Malawi, particularly sobering from David. I was there in 2005, and I think you could see back then what the climate impacts were, particularly around the variability of rains and, you know, terrifying what things might look like in the years ahead. Can I ask you, David, then, about the, you know, you raised in your submission about the small grants program, and I think one thing that stuck in my mind when I went to the country was just the impact of those CBOs as community-based organizations doing a lot of work with very small amounts of money. You said here that the small grants program that was stopped by the Scottish Government was a misstep, and you pointed to some of the difficulties around, you know, evaluation of that scheme. Can you say a bit more about that, and how do you think that evaluation of small grant schemes can be improved? Because obviously public money and accounting for public money for development work is really important. So how can we continue to do that kind of work, but also build confidence that the money's going to the right places and it's actually achieving objectives?
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks very much. I think the Small Grants Programme is probably one of the best bits of what the Scottish Government has achieved through its International Development Programme over the last 16, 17 years or so. Important to emphasise, as others have already done, that the scale of the total package from Scotland, even with the decision to decrease from 0.7 to 0.5% of GNI south of the border, it's still about 1,000 times smaller in Scotland. And that's not a criticism of Scotland, because it's additional to, and hence all the more meaningful. But even within that pot, small grants programme is a very small component. It's always been under half a million, under 500,000. But what they've looked to try and do with that pot historically is to not say, what can we do with a single project of that amount of about 500,000, but rather, what if we actually thought differently? What if we thought innovatively about how do we support perhaps a dozen or two dozen different projects, long-standing, smaller projects, that be able to work with Malawi with much smaller quantities of money? And by doing that, it was able to engage a very different section of civic society, you know, both in Scotland and in Malawi. Certainly my experience of seeing firsthand on the ground the impact of some of those small grants was remarkable. And this isn't absolutely a coded criticism to larger organisations and more structural approaches, which are equally important. But I was astonished at the value for impact that you could see on the ground for what incredibly small, relatively small quantities of money we're achieving through principally volunteer-run organisations. But I think the small grants programme was particularly well thought through in that it looked to not just deliver project grants, but also capacity building grants, and grants that allowed organisations to say, look, we've got a great idea, but we just need to put a bit of research and a bit of thought. We need to put time into listening to our colleagues and counterparts in Malawi to develop this idea before we start the doing. And I think what really made the Small Grants Programme such a success was the management style of the Cora Foundation, who I think did a fantastic job, again, with remarkably little money. I think to a huge degree, your success in this space is determined by your values and your approach. And the Cora Foundation has always been very clear that it has a supportive and empathetic approach. It's helped those smaller organisations to be able to apply for funds. It's recognised that if a small volunteer-run organisation doesn't have a staff member who's well-versed in all the language you should put into application forms, but beyond the forms, they picked up the phone and they spent an hour, maybe an hour and a half for each applicant, just talking to them about it, listening to them and their Malawian partners, understanding what was proposed, and working with them through the life of the grant to ensure that it was a success. I expressed my reservations from the outset in the way that the review of the small grants program was set up. If you look at the terms of reference of that review, it says that it shouldn't actually consider the impact that projects have had. And I completely agree what you said, Mark. This is taxpayers' money, and absolutely it must be led by evidence. But I don't see how you can review the success of a program without looking at the success of projects within it. In fact, the terms of reference don't necessarily require the contractor to even look at whether the program's objectives had succeeded. The criticism that the end report had was that there wasn't clear evidence of the success against the objectives of the program, but it was very clear that's because of the way the objectives were written at the beginning. It wasn't necessarily due to any failure of the program, but just it's hard to measure because of the way the wording was when it was first set out. And certainly I look at the rest of the International Development Program, and I'm not convinced all the other units do have easily measurable objectives, and I think that's probably a fair point where improvements can be made. I certainly don't think that's a reason to have cancelled the small grants program. In fact, if you look at the recommendations of that report, the recommendation with the greatest number of sort of reasons to support it, the most bullet points of saying this is a good idea, was to keep the small grants program. And the decision that was made to cancel it actually had the fewest number of points recommending it and the most number of reservations. So I do slightly raise an eyebrow at a case being made that report showed that there wasn't demonstrable empirical value from the small grants program, because I don't think it does. Mm-hmm. And certainly my experience of working with those organizations, both who have been successful and even those who are unsuccessful in their applications with the small grants program, the sector here speaks with one voice, that actually this was a uniquely supportive, fantastic program with a remarkable return on investment. It was a manifesto commitment in the last Parliament that small grants program would be continued, and I stand by our words in the submission that we do see it as a policy misstep that it was cancelled despite that manifesto commitment.
Okay, thanks. Can I ask Lewis then, just on a different topic, just going back to policy coherence? I think you're quite so you diplomatically talked about the company in Fife. I think you know you're talking about Raytheon and the camp management that Scottish Enterprise were supplying for that arms company. Do you think there are significant policy coherence issues that still exist? Because we've talked about successes, not talked about perhaps where there are some real tensions. And also, can I ask you specifically about, you know, you're working on the you know, sustainable well-being bill that's coming forward, you've been inputting into that. Do you see a role, say, for a Future Generations Commission in terms of providing some of the governance on sustainable development going forward? And so that's one for Lewis.
Thanks, Mark. I think so. The reality is, when it comes to policy coherence, without systems, without proper systems in place across government and across Parliament and across other public bodies too, it's actually very difficult to ensure that examples of incoherences become less frequent. So in other words, without systems in place, the frequency of incoherences will continue as it currently is, and there is a potential that these things will come up more often even. So that's part of the rationale for why we've called for a well-being sustainable development bill. I think you know, there are examples of where we can, where we have not yet chosen to see things through that lens, and that could lead to potential problems, the most current of which was perhaps the Good Food Nation Bill. And that bill has the power to be something quite all-encompassing if seen through a lens beyond the remit of the particular committee that's working on it. I know that the Scottish Food Coalition recently submitted their evidence to that committee suggesting such an approach. You know, a Good Food Nation Bill must, by definition, include the impacts of how food is produced and grown in other parts of the world. What are the impacts on the livelihoods of those growers and farmers across the world? What's the climate impact and environmental impact of that food production and waste as a result? The remit of such a bill, if it was being scrutinised at this stage by multiple different angles, could perhaps extend to these issues and also give us a potential chance to limit the incoherence or trade-off that might come as a result of putting a Good Food Nation Bill through Parliament. That's one current example. I think, you know, there are always going to be examples, both large and small. I mean, the business pledge that came about, to give a very small example, that isn't widely used. We know this. The business pledge has all the right intention. But again, if we had just included an international aspect to that business pledge, we might have captured some other businesses that do particular actions and have a remit out with the borders of Scotland to perhaps just consider how they function in relation to the social, economic and environmental outcomes elsewhere. So I think that's a couple of examples for you. When it comes to the Future Generations Commissioner aspect of a Wellbeing Sustainable Development Bill, part of the research that we've done is looked at the Welsh experience. Obviously, there is our Future Generations Commissioner in Wales. One of the criticisms of that commissioner is that it lacks teeth. The commissioner does not have the powers to hold the government accountable or to, indeed, to force changes in directions. So a Future Generations Commissioner is welcomed as part of such a bill, but only if the mechanisms for accountability exist and the duties can be legally enforced by said commissioner. So legislation that looks at well-being and sustainable development must have an international dimension. By definition, sustainable development is global, not domestic. It includes all of us everywhere and everything. Yet, if a Future Generation Commission is put through and money is invested, we would probably say it wouldn't have value unless the legislation that links to this commissioner has the teeth and the power to really hold government account.
Okay, thanks. And then just briefly, I had a question for Mark as well. I mean, you mentioned in your submission about, you know, the need to support new EU-based foundations. I wonder if you had particular examples of where, even though, you know, we've left the EU, there are still policy areas where we can and we should be focusing in on and developing new initiatives or looking to join existing EU foundations that can be working outside of the EU as well.
Yeah, certainly. I think that part of the rationale that I had when I made my submission, and we've been doing a lot of work within the university looking at the feasibility of this, is actually setting up foundations which are based in Europe but have an international flavour, but come from Scottish universities, Scottish organisations, so they have a footprint there and can work from there and benefit, obviously, from European funding, which is important. If you look across Spain, there are many organisations that, in one way or other, are helping to helping civic society organisations access European funding for areas such as climate change and working intrinsically with universities, but working independently, and they benefit from the European funding, but they also benefit as taking a consultancy role, and especially if they have international networks. So it seemed like a model to me that we should at least be exploring as a way of helping us to continue engage with Europe and to continue engage with our partners within Europe. there are small examples. For example, Strathclyde has a research centre that post Brexit has turned into a foundation within the Netherlands in Delft, but very, very specific on European policy. But that model then can be extrapolated in various forms across Europe, and you know, doing the due diligence of the best location. And I don't mean just in order to engage with other European partners, but as we know, European funding works across the world, and GCU benefited enormously, but also helped partners in Latin America and Southeast Asia and South Africa benefit from European funding. We were kind of acting as agencies for that funding. And I think that if you look at what's happening to funding within the UK now, with GCRF, the Global Challenges Research Fund, and my colleagues were talking about evaluation and everything, and that kind of funding was fantastic for evaluating these kind of projects. GCRF has now been suspended by the UK government. We know that the British Council is losing funding. These are the kind of funds that allow us to have influence across the world, and they're very small, is small amounts of funding, but really help us to engage. So on the one hand, I would say that we need to look at that funding at a Scottish level, but also I see this development of European foundations and European presence as a way of helping us to continue to use European funding to help us with small projects like this.
Thanks very much. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Could I invite Ms. Mintel to ask questions, please?
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, panel. This has been very informative. I'm interested, if I can first ask maybe David Hope-Jones, but others may wish to comment on it as well. In your evidence, you said that there was a distinctively Scottish approach to international development. So I just wondered if you could expand on that, perhaps with a few examples from your Malawi experiences. Thank you.
Thanks very, very much indeed. I mean, I suppose for me, it's important that for an inquiry like this, the committee takes us of a big picture. That means with all sort of humility, looking at it from a sort of historical and existential, a constitutional viewpoint. Why does Scotland do international development? Why does the Scottish Government do international development? And the case that I would make is because that actually, you know, Scotland as a nation has developed something quite distinctive in its approach to progressive internationalism, particularly as expressed in the bilateral relationship with Malawi. 17 years ago, the Scottish Executive, as First Minister Lord McConnell, went out to Malawi. He fell in love with Malawi, as countless Scots had done before and since. And he was really struck by the scale of civic links that he saw across Malawi. He was amazed that you could go across Malawi and reliably the people that you would meet would be banging on about Scotland and about their church link and their school link, their university link, the charities that they were involved in. And I've spoken to Lord McConnell about this. He was genuinely bowled over. He came back and he started speaking to people in Scotland. And he saw the same glimmer, that spark in people's eyes, that enthusiasm that was there for working with Malawi, and what his sense was that was quite distinctive from the sadly dominant paradigm of the day of an international development industry that was based at that point more on an assumption that, you know, we in the global north have the answers for the global south, that what works in Madagascar can be unproblematically transplanted to work in Malawi, that wasn't particularly interested in listening to people on the ground in a meaningful way. And the business case that was, I suppose, made at that point constitutionally was that there was a useful value add that Scotland and the Scottish Government could make in supporting those civic links to be able to achieve something quite distinctive. It never set out to, you know, emulate or replicate what the UK government was doing with DFID, now FCDO. And I think there's a real danger that if we lose that self-awareness, if we lose that big picture, if we lose that humility, we try and spread the jam too thinly. And inevitably, for practical reasons, that would mean sacrificing the principal foundations on which all of this is built. And key amongst those principles, I would say, would be dignified partnership, real, meaningful, human partnerships, and a recognition of the value that all of civic society can have. The bilateral relationship between Scotland and Malawi isn't limited to, it's not even defined by the governmental relationship. The president of Malawi said exactly that, speaking at our AGM in the autumn. He commended the Scottish government for recognising that the bilateral relationship was far more than that. It was these 1,200 civic links, these 109,000 Scots, 208,000 Malawians working together in dignified human partnership, and the constructive synergy between the governmental, the parliamentary, and the civic society. That's what's so extraordinary. Every single one of the 129 MSPs has Malawi civic links in their constituencies. That means there's that all-party political support that encourages the Scottish government, that applauds the Scottish government when they work in this space, and that support then feeds back to civic society. And you have a virtuous circle there of a national effort between Scotland and Malawi, which is remarkable. For every pound that the Scottish government puts into the Scotland-Malawi partnership, more than £200 comes from Scottish civic society. There's no other country in the world that can say that. That's something exciting and that's something special. And my encouragement to the committee is to in turn encourage the Scottish government to not lose sight of those principles that were foundational at the start of this process, of this journey 17 years ago. It is to the immense credit of successive Scottish governments, but particularly the current Scottish government, for the increase in the scale of the International Development Programme from 3 to 4 to 9 to 10, now to 15 million in the life of this parliament. But even at that level, you know, it's comparable with the Island of Jersey's International Development Programme. You know, we can't kid on that this is a world-changing quantity of money, however good it is. And so my encouragement would be to focus on that distinctive approach that values civic mobilisation in countries, that has dignified partnership at its heart, that's able to support good governance through the constructive synergy between the non-governmental and the governmental and parliament, and is based on a reciprocal approach. I'm afraid our meeting today is too short for me to go through a great many examples, but what I would say is perhaps I could just give a hyperlink to a single document that has 1,200 different examples disaggregated by every Holyrood constituency, showing hundreds of schools, hundreds of churches, all universities in Scotland, half the local authorities, a great many businesses, all working in this way, underpinned by mutual respect and human solidarity. There's something very special there. And I think while we grow the scale of what's happening at a governmental level, which is fantastic, let's not lose the principal foundations on which this has been built. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. Yes, I'm very much smiled at your comment about people to people conversations, because people are people the world over, and I think that's where we have to I think that's basically what we have to recognise. And I'm looking forward to visiting Oban High School in the near future, which is in my constituency. I wonder, Lewis, have you got any thoughts on and comments that you'd like to make about a distinctively Scottish approach and not following not being able, I suppose, given the size of the funding available, the more defined route that we expect from perhaps DFID or the Foreign and Commonwealth Office?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, much of what David has said, I would echo, primarily on the value and distinctiveness of the civil society and, as you just mentioned, people-to-people connections that are created out of Scotland with people elsewhere. But I would obviously add that that's not limited to Malawi. And actually, if the same assessment was done, and it's sadly not yet been done, and it's something we plan to do across other countries, not just the four partner countries that the Scottish Government has, but beyond that, in all continents of the world, we'll find those people-to-people connections are even more vibrant than 1,200 connections. And that needs to be celebrated, emphasised and invested in. There's also something else here, though, that we must be upfront and frank about the direction that the UK government has taken latterly with its own international engagement post-Brexit, and what is defined as global Britain and what that means, and what Scotland can do to work with but also to prove that there is potentially an alternative path in terms of international engagement. And it is clear that the funds available for the government are limited, but that does not mean that examples cannot be set across a range of areas that might be scaled up. So yes, I agree that civil society and our members are proof of that too. They operate in people-to-people relationships from all sizes and types of organisations across a range of different sectors, not just the NGO world. But there are examples of, for example, the recent decision on loss and damage funding that are not going to make a massive difference to the global significance of loss and damage funding when it comes to climate. But the fact that we can be a beacon of hope to use the language, the rhetoric, and start a process, other sub-state actors, other regions, the Jersey example or others around the world may get behind, and then suddenly you can scale something up. So I think it's important to recognise the potential that a country like Scotland has to be a world leader on particular issues. The way in which we structure our funding and the themes that we approach, whether it's supporting LGBTQI communities across the world, whether it's supporting women and girls in new ways, as I know the minister has recently announced an equalities fund that will do just that. I think these are positive steps, and I think they should be lauded as examples of the distinctive approach as well.
Great, thank you, Lewis. And if I can just ask you one specific.
Well, I think we've lost connection to Ms. Minto. Sorry, Jenny, we lost your connection there. Could you
okay, you got me back.
Yeah, can I just say we are really tight for time now, so if we could have succinct answers, that would be really helpful. Ms. Minto.
Great. I was just saying I was at a couple of COP fringe events. I'm not sure if you can hear me. And there was a comment about the cost of doing nothing is more than the cost of doing something. So I just wonder if you could expand on your statement where you've asked for supporting calls for cancellation of all external debt payments. Lewis, if you could expand on that, please.
That's a really good example of where the powers of the Parliament and the Scottish Government, unfortunately, do not allow us to support this in any other meaningful way other than rhetoric. But we saw what the First Minister was able to do by using rhetoric at a COP that was UK government-led in order to change narratives and support new ways of thinking. When it comes to the cancellation of debt and debt jubilee more widely, there isn't broad consensus, and most of the powerful nations of the world do not get on board. It takes leadership from small sub-state significant actors such as Scotland to be able to change that narrative. So it takes policy statements, it takes repeated public statements on particular issues to be able to make progress on these and lead by example. Sadly, you know, other than the informal pressure that can be put on the UK government through Scottish government channels, there isn't much more that the Scottish government can do at this stage. But it is encouraged by our members across the piece that such supporting statements can be made by the Scottish Government.
Okay. Thank you, Lewis. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ms. Boyack, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. And to the witnesses, it's very good to read your submissions in advance of our discussion today. It feels like there's two core areas that have come up. One is about the funds that are spent on international development, whether it's the International Development Fund, the Climate Justice Fund, and then the loss of the Small Grants Fund, and then the issue about a much more cross-cutting approach right across government policy. So I've got two questions, Convener. Firstly is to ask the witnesses about how we get more value and how we measure that value from the existing finance through the International Development Fund and the Climate Justice Fund, and what witnesses think about the Small Grants Fund. And I was thinking of firstly going to David Hope Jones answer that question.
Thank you very much. Following the convener's steer, I'll try and be as brief as I can be. In our submission, we say a few different things, but probably the one that I would pick out in brevity is transparency and accountability. You know, 10 million in the grand scheme of things isn't a huge amount. 15 million, fantastic. But actually, we still need to have really tight systems to ensure that we're getting maximum value for that. Historically, there was a call for applications every year. Almost everything had a competitive process that was clear and transparent. I could say to our members, okay, don't apply this year, develop the concept, apply in 12 months' time. I can't do that now because, you know, there might be a call in 5 years' time, but it depends on the whim of the day. There's not the predictability, the transparency and the accountability. I think almost everything other than, you know, the core funding for organizations that's gone on for sort of 15 or 17 years, there should be competitively tendered for, because that's what builds confidence and builds awareness. And I'm worried that an outcome of the review is that while that there is a principle that says transparency and accountability, actually the different strands of grant making, none of them require the Scottish Government to have a transparent process. So I think that's hugely important, that it's predictable, that it's transparent, and it's accountable. And following that, I think you'll get best value for money.
Thanks. And Lewis Ryder-Jones, you also talked about the importance of the value that comes from our international development funds and how we actually make the most of that. Do you want to say a bit more on that issue?
I mean, I can very, very, very quickly just echo the comments on transparency and the need for the need for organisations who may or may not want to apply for grant funding through these funds to have the transparency and ability to plan for these grants. So I very much echo what David said in that regard. I think, however, actually, you know, beyond the transparency issue, what's been striking at a parliamentary level over the years is that when international development funding has been debated in the chamber or otherwise, there hasn't been the level of understanding of what that money has been spent on across the parliament, and therefore scrutiny has potentially been missing as well. It's often been a very positive conversation on the successful relationship building that this funding has come about, less so on the impact of projects across the partner countries. So I would propose that the Parliament has a role to play to ensure that value for money as well, and to ensure that meaningful debate is had on that spend. Just one other point I would make is that the International Development Fund should not be seen in isolation, and it goes back to that policy coherence. We cannot see value for money unless we see it as connected to everything else that's going on within the Scottish context, and again, the Parliament has a role to ensure that.
Thanks very much. I mean, that takes me on to my second question, because one thing that's come through from all three witnesses is the importance of that broader approach, that sustainable development approach and a joined up approach. And I think from all the witnesses we've heard that. So I would like a little bit more about how we do get that change in other government spending and other government policy that actually delivers in sustainable development, that feeds into international development ambitions that we've got, not just the 15 million, but how do you get the rest of the Scottish Government's money actually playing a positive part? And can I maybe start off with Mark Majewski-Anderson from Glasgow Caledonian, because you talked a bit at the start about how you actually deliver on the ground, and just to think through for the further and higher education sector, what sustainable development means in an international development context.
Yeah, I think there are two areas, and thank you, because I've been wanting to come in the debate for some time to kind of mention these, because when we're talking about policy coherence, I think higher education, we've got a real opportunity in two areas. One is we've talked a lot about evaluation and impact, and I think our researchers in a variety of areas are well positioned to be able to do this, and have been doing this for many years through different strands of funding. And this is a way of actually increasing the added value of what we're doing. So we're actually increasing our research and our research and our base knowledge base but also being able to demonstrate impact. And there's an increasing amount of what we term pracademics, who are not just academics, but are also working on the ground and helping facilitate improvements as well as measurements. The second area that I would say is really crucial, that I think there's a lot more we can do, is student mobility. And as we know, we've now lost the Erasmus grant, which was great for European mobility, but also for mobility of students across the world. We've lost that, and it's been replaced by Turing, which is one direction only. In other words, it helps our students travel to other places. What we've completely lost, and which really adds value, is the idea of giving opportunity for mobility to the new generation coming out of the a developing world, where they're able to benefit from our education systems, but then return to their own countries. So far less of us coming in and helping the countries, but really kind of planting the seeds to be able to develop further. And I think this, if we're talking about the way to make money go further, I think to really invest in student and research and mobility, to be able to for students from different countries around the world to benefit from the Scottish education system, which, by the way, is probably, in terms of our international renown, the HE sector in Scotland is probably without equal across the world in terms per capita. So I think this is something that we can really invest into.
Thanks very much. That's really useful. And Lewis Ryder-Jones, to move on to that wider issue, you've talked about other areas where the Scottish Government could act in terms of the wellbeing and sustainable development agenda. And you've mentioned issues like public procurement, public policy and leadership, and business practice. Could you give us a sense of what the Scottish Government can do in its other money, not just the money on international development, and using public bodies and agencies to make a positive impact on sustainable development, climate development, climate justice?
Yeah, I mean, at its heart, really, that's about creating global citizens in Scotland. So without an increasing awareness amongst the general public of how their own actions impact the social, environmental and economic outcomes of people elsewhere, I don't think we can really make genuine progress on this. So a big part of legislation to that degree must include an element of upskilling both of the civil servants, of parliamentarians and the wider public on how our actions actually impact. We can't, if we ever could, decouple our own actions from what happens elsewhere. So whether it's in whether it's a procurement plan for a particular public body, or if it's the expansion plan of a particular business, we must have a starting point where we are aware that what types of questions we need to ask ourselves to ensure that we're making those decisions based on all the information that we may have. So I think a big part of legislation to that degree should be about upskilling. It should be about ensuring the right questions are asked. And that sadly does mean probably more work for people. We must be honest with ourselves about that, that it's not achieving sustainable development and thinking about global impact is not an easy process. It makes what we do more difficult, but that's important. We're at a point, a global point in history, where if we don't make things more difficult for ourselves in that regard, then we will fail the future generations that are yet to join us on this planet. So I think it's as simple as that. We must accept that our jobs are going to be more difficult.
Thanks. And David Hope Jones, in your evidence, you commented that the benefits to Malawi, additional investment of £49 million on top of what's presumably quite a small amount of pump priming money. Can you say a bit more about how that wider approach that Lewis has just talked about having a wider approach to sustainable development and changing other Scottish Government policies could actually benefit people in Malawi?
Yeah, absolutely. The multiplier effect that the Scottish Government has with its programme to Malawi is extraordinary. And that's because of the energy and vibrancy of wider Scottish civic society. And I think that the critical point that I would make is joining up the governmental and the non-governmental is absolutely key. Scotland is a small nation. Again, humility and self-awareness. We are not going to change the world, certainly not with these sort of quantities of monies in the public purse. But the thing that we can do, the way we can box clever, is to connect things up. I completely agree with what Mark was saying about higher education. This time Monday, I was meeting with Vice Chancellor of Dundee University, listening to him passionately talk about the desire for them to grow their works with Malawi. This time yesterday, I was listening to 12 different Malawi projects in the University of Strathclyde, looking at the impact that they're having despite the challenges of the COVID pandemic. The opportunities to connect up are absolutely huge, and that's how we'll deliver far more as a country. So my encouragement is, let's try and get out of these boxes, have better conversations between government and civic society, and to unleash the awesome force of all of that enthusiasm and the expertise that I think we've got, because there's real willingness there in these institutions, in these associations across Scotland.
Thanks, Computer.
Thank you. Can I say thank you very much to our panel this morning. In some aspects of our discussion today, I think we've only just scratched the surface of what we could be looking into in much more detail, particularly struck by Mark's comments about the foundations and how we might develop working in Europe. And hopefully we will be able to come back to these issues over the course of our inquiry, and just to say that one of the first projects I was aware of was Malawi midwives being trained virtually at Caledonian University of Western Scotland, and that was a long number of years ago. And to see these projects in action, I think it really brings it home to us how effective they can be. So huge thank you to you all this morning, and I'm going to suspend just for a moment to allow the panels to change over. I'm not going to have a comfort break, if that's okay with the committee, and move to our next panel. Thank you. Welcome back. And our next agenda item is our committee's inquiry into the UK internal market. This will be the committee's fourth panel on this topic this morning, and the committee will hear from Jonathan Scott, Non-Executive Director and Chair of the Competition and Markets Authority, Rachel Marielli, Senior Director of the Office of International Markets, and Sheila Scobie, Director of the Office for Internal Market. Can I welcome you all to the meeting this morning, and thank you very much for providing your written submission. We're going to move straight to questions, and I remind my colleagues to put an R in the chat if they wish to ask a question. And I can maybe just open with a question. Mr. Scott, can you please elaborate on the OIM's role in providing reports or advice on specific regulatory provisions upon the request of the relevant national authority, particularly interested in the transparency of this work, and will requests of a national authority or any advice given be made public, or the parliamentary committees or the parliamentary legislatures be informed of such advice?
Convener, thank you very much indeed. I will ask Rachel to deal with the detail of this question, but I think what I would like to get over is the importance of what we are trying to achieve at the OIM, and that is that we are going to give advice that is independent, that is impartial, and that is evidence-based. And I guess that takes us back, if you like, to what the Competition and Markets Authority everyday activity is around. It's around understanding markets, how they operate, and making that accessible. And I think making that accessible is probably the sort of handover for me to Rachel.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. And thank you, convener. yes, the Office for the Internal Market has two kind of broad functions. One is a broad monitoring and reporting function, but the narrower one, which I think you're asking about specifically, is in terms of providing advice or reports on specific regulatory provisions, either before they're made or after they've been made. And the national authorities can come to us with a request for those reports or advice, and can also ask us for advice on a regulatory provision that another national authority has made if they feel that might be detrimental to the internal market.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from the committee and could invite first Mr. Ruskell.
Yeah, thanks, convener, and good morning to you both. I wanted to ask you about engagement, in particular, how you're engaging with different groups. I mean, obviously, with the European Union, there's very deep engagement at both, you know, policy and implementation level, which I think, you know, stakeholders have been used to up to now. But in terms of your role, how are you engaging in particular with businesses, but also other stakeholders as well, those representing consumers, perhaps even regulators as well? And what does that actually look like? What does the program of work look like? How are you ensuring that your work is transparent and that you're actually able to take on the views and communicate effectively with those groups of stakeholders? So if you could give us some detail on that would be most useful.
Mr. Scott, please come in.
I think it's probably just right to put this in context, particularly as we're before a committee of the Scottish Parliament. In Scotland, we've now had an office for a number of years. We've got, I think, approximately 60 people. Those numbers will continue to rise. And we have had a programme of engagement with Parliament, with the committees, and much more widely. So, for example, we had a consultation on our annual plan at the beginning of this week with stakeholders from industry, from consumer bodies. But if I may, I will ask Sheila Scobie just to give a little more detail, because she has both led our office in Edinburgh since inception, but has now moved over to a director role in the OIM. I think reflecting, Mr. Ruskell, the point that you've made, that it is absolutely critical if we are going to do this role well, that we engage and we engage widely. So if I may, can I ask Sheila just to flesh out a little bit what I've said?
Yes, thanks, Jonathan, and hello, Mr. Ruskell. Very glad that you've asked this question, actually, because it's really a key to what we're working on at the moment, and was a very strong message that we got in response to our consultation on our guidance last summer. That a really important purpose for our first year should be about engaging with important stakeholders, building awareness, but most importantly, building trust in the OIM as an institution that can actually advise and help with what are quite complex and sensitive issues. So very much we're building on our existing relationships. As Jonathan said, I've been the director in the PMA responsible for outreach in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland for quite a number of years, got a really strong network of contacts across the business community and with consumer bodies like Citizens Advice Scotland, which in Scotland are now increasingly developing a good relationship with the emergent Consumer Scotland. And so as part of our work to develop the OIM, but also since launch, we've been reaching out to business organisations like CBI, Federation of Small Businesses, and now increasingly some of the sectoral organisations, particularly I think in sectors that we think are likely to be most in scope, perhaps like the food and drink sector, the environmental sector and others.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So what does that actually practically look like? I mean, you know, can you give us a worked example for, you know, around engagement on a particular issue might be useful?
Yeah, certainly. So we ran a number of business roundtables around the guidance that we produced in the summer. We issued that for consultation in draft form very early days in our development of our design for the OIM. So we're very keen to understand where businesses might be coming from and what would be helpful to them. And one of the things that we had already identified we needed to do was to provide an easily accessible platform for businesses and business organisations come to the OIM with issues that they were experiencing. So we now do have that online web platform. We are working with the business organisations to expand awareness of it and directing people. As Jonathan said, we've sent messages and emails out to people that have attended our various engagement events to encourage them to come forward with issues. But also just being wise, you know, tapping into news and information and actually things that the Parliament is doing and the sessions that you have been doing, you've been following those very, very carefully as well, to really try and understand and test how much familiarity there is with our work, but also the best way of engaging. And I think looking forward, as I say, we want to really plug into those sectors that are most relevant. And as we sort of develop our understanding of what the evidence is telling us, we're running this business survey, for example, to help inform our first report. That will help us, I think, identify what the need is and what the best sorts of engagement will be going forward. I mean, clearly, if there are ways that we can tap into existing forum or any ways that parliamentarians can put us in touch with relevant sectors and businesses, we'd be very open to hearing about that.
Yeah, and I was watching the little video that introduces the role. I think useful for particularly for consumers and others. And you talk in that video about the health of the internal market. What do you define as that? What are the top health indicators?
Now that's a very good question, and it's something that we've been working very closely with the government, the analytical experts in governments, but also people like Fraser Rallander and other academics in the Office of National Statistics to help us understand what would be the right measures for defining what the health of the internal market would be. I mean, effectively, we're looking at making sure that trade is effective across different parts of the UK, and any sort of subsequent issues that some sort of barriers to trade might create for competition, for innovation, perhaps investment. And then also, obviously, leading into what effects there might be for consumers in terms of prices and choice. So those are the sorts of things that we're very familiar as an organisation with tracking. We do it probably at quite a macro level at the moment. But you know, we do have experience of dipping into sectors and getting a real sense of what's going on. And so we have the expertise. I would say that we are still working on defining exactly what that evidence base will be going forward, and we're looking for, as I say, support from others who are expert in what is quite a new and quite novel policy area, I would say, because we've not in the UK had much history of sort of tracking the effectiveness of trade between different parts of the UK. That's something that we do quite effectively in the international context, but it's something that we're really keen to build up our expertise in and become a centre of expertise in.
Yeah. And then just finally, I was going to ask you about, you know, where you see regulation in terms of driving the innovation that can create a healthy market. Because yes, clearly, as the regulatory innovation comes in, businesses and industry have to think about how they adapt to that, and that can create a lot of economic growth and innovation. So I'd essentially, it's about creating a level playing field, but it's also about, like, how do you ensure that there's a space there for innovative regulation to drive that innovation market?
Yes, I mean, I think definitely with our CMA hats on, we would say that we very much recognise that, and that resonates with a lot of the other work that the CMA does looking into markets. And if you look at some of the work we've done on things like heat networks, for example, we've been very proactive at encouraging governments to think about how they can design those markets effectively. I mean, I think from an OIM perspective, it's not really for us to make decisions about what the most effective means is of designing policy and designing regulation. We can certainly assist with helping governments understand what the potential effects would be, and we can maybe make suggestions as to how they can best design policies that deliver those wider public benefits, but bearing in mind those economic effects that I've mentioned that we are particularly expert in, but we're not there to provide the expertise on those wider public benefits. That's very much for governments to put into the mix and make decisions about.
Okay, thanks. If there's no more contributions, I'll go back to yourself, convener.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Boyack, please?
Thanks very much, convener. I was very interested in the paper we had submitted in advance of today's committee, and particularly where the request was made to really get our views as a committee. And I think for me, the issue about how you assist parliamentary scrutiny and support us in that, because there's big issues for stakeholders and businesses, I think, as has been already mentioned, transparency, impact to markets. And I think one of the things I would just appreciate a comment on is where you've got a strong desire to raise standards and support innovation on issues like could be animal welfare and food quality in response to consumer demands, or maybe in relation to higher standards to meet climate change targets, particularly in the light of COP26 and the UK's leadership. So what kind of advice would you be giving, and what transparency will you be able to support, enable us to do our work in terms of looking at regulations and looking at government policies on those sort of issues? I'm not sure who that's best targeted to as a question, convener, though maybe the witnesses could volunteer.
If we go to Jonathan, I'm sure Mr. Scott will nominate someone if he's not.
I think I will let Rachel take that one, if I may.
Thank you.
Yes, of course. Very happy to pick that up, and thank you for the question, Ms. Boyack. Yes, I think that as Sheila was explaining, the expertise that we bring is to look at the economic impacts of any regulatory provisions. So we're trying to gather data. We're trying to assess the impacts, the technical impacts, the economic impacts of any sort of proposed provisions, whether they are in climate change or animal welfare or any other space, at the request of national authorities. I think it's important to say that these wider policy decisions are very much decisions for Parliament, for the governments. And we're very happy, as Sheila was saying, to assist on this sort of technical front, but wouldn't presume to do the kind of balancing act of the wider political considerations, policy considerations, and those more sort of technical assessments. You asked about sort of transparency. I think this is, and I probably should have picked this up more in my first response too. I mean, we're wholly committed to being transparent. It's very important to us. I think the CMA as a whole has a commitment to transparency. We publish a lot of reports and details of the work that we carry out. And that same sort of commitment to transparency is something that we carry across into the Office of the Internal Market. I think the convener may have been asking a little bit previously too about the transparency that we might be able to give on sort of early pieces of advice. And I think this is where we're working very closely with governments to understand what they want, actually, because the only areas I think where we're not required to be transparent is for our what are termed our Section 34 pieces of advice, which are about regulatory provisions before they're passed or made. And our ambition is to be as transparent as possible, but there may be occasions where we're asked to comment on something which is not yet in the public domain. And there we need to be quite careful. And obviously, I think governments would want to have some protection, and we would discuss with them what was appropriate to do on a case by case basis. I hope that starts to answer your question, Ms. Boyack.
On one level, it starts to answer my question. Another, it's quite. My follow up. I was thinking about that issue about publishing advice to different governments, because one of the things that actually has been apparent in devolution is governments watching each other have different best practice. You could call it best practice or different standards. And it's just to what extent there's a scope for that cross UK sharing of knowledge and information about markets, and whether you're up for doing that, to publish your advice to different governments?
Yes, very much so. And that is our default setting, if you like, is to publish our advice. It's just that, as I say, we need to work closely with governments to make sure that we aren't putting something in the public domain too early. But in general terms, very much committed to that sharing, and we're working closely with all four governments to try to establish our ways of working. I mean, I think it's also important to say that these are very early days for us. We haven't yet had a request for advice, and it's obviously, although we've been talking about these things on a sort of theoretical basis, it's when we actually have to start dealing with requests that I think some of these issues really come to light, and we're able to sort of push on the transparency side, as you're suggesting.
Yeah, I think from our experience that the discussions we've had on internal markets and frameworks, huge appetite from business community and stakeholders to actually have advanced sight of things, because the change, to adapt to change, as much information and as much of a heads up as possible is what people are after. So I think that commitment to transparency, even in terms of government advice, is something that we would be very keen to see.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you. Could I just ask a supplementary on that, following my introductory question? So in a situation that advice was given to, say, the UK government or to the Welsh Assembly, for instance, would the other governments be made aware of that publication, even if it isn't in the public domain? As such, would all governments be informed of what advice had been given and where?
No, thank you, Convener, for following up. These are issues that we're working through as we talk. As I say, our default is very much to share with all four governments. That's what we aim to do. But there may be occasions on specific cases where that's difficult to achieve. So we really do have to look at this, I think, on a case by case basis.
Thank you. Could I invite questions from Ms. Mintel, please?
I'd like to return to the questions that Mr. Ruskell was asking about engagement. And I note that you have done an initial stakeholder survey, and I just wondered what key learnings you got out of that. I did notice that there was one about being even-handed. So I just wondered if you could explain about that, maybe expand a bit on that statement, please. Mr. Scott?
Good. Sorry, forgive me, I wasn't sure it had come to me. I'm going to let Sheila deal with the detail, but can I say a word or two on the even-handedness, because I think this is so fundamental. And if I may, I'm going to go sort of back a stage. For the CMA, we are an independent, non-governmental, I always get my terminology wrong here, but we're a non-ministerial government department, but we are independent. And that is absolutely at the heart of all the work that we do, whether it's in our mergers, markets, consumers. So for us, questions of even-handedness and independence in the OIM, for me as chair, carry very, very real risk of contagion across to what we do in all our work. So even-handedness and independence has to be absolutely front and centre of what we do, what we're seen to do, what we're perceived to do. And I think that's why we've gone down the structure that we recommended to government that we went down the structure we did, which is the structure involving both the OIM being housed within the CMA, but also the panel system. And we'll come back to that later. But that is, if you like, a further guarantee, I hope, of independence and even-handedness. But to go to the survey results, I will let Sheila take that, if I may.
Yes, certainly, Jonathan. So I referred to the business survey, which we've been running through the autumn. It hasn't yet completed. We're still waiting for the final results, and we'll then want to have a look at those and do a bit of analysis on those and present those in the most effective way. And we're intending doing that as part of our report in the spring, which will be published and made available. So that's where that is. On the even-handed point, just to sort of go a little bit further into the detail, there is a requirement in the legislation for us to act in an even-handed way, and we are, as Jonathan said, taking that very seriously, almost going beyond what we might normally do within the CMA. And that would sort of filter into some of the work that we do is discretionary, so we have a choice to make as to which cases and projects that we take up, and it may be that we will embed that notion of even-handedness in deciding which projects, which reports that we should fulfil. Also, just in terms of the analysis and use of evidence, you know, it is sometimes difficult getting comparative data across the different nations of the UK, as you'll probably be aware, and something that we're really intent on doing is to improve the evidence base, and very much doing that on the basis that we can make evidence-based decisions and reach conclusions that are not sort of reflect what some people have told to us as being the asymmetry between different parts of the UK. So we'll be very focused on trying to get that right. But also just in the way that we communicate and engage with each of the four administrations, making sure that we share information on an equal basis, that we deal with things on an equitable basis, and that we, as we were saying earlier, that we make sure that in our ways of working, we're working collectively, and we're not having conversations with one government and not having the same conversation with all four of them. And I think actually we've learned quite a bit, I think, from the way the Common Frameworks programme has been developed, very much trying to work on the same collaborative basis with all four administrations.
Okay, thank you for that. I was struck when you said that, I don't mean to misquote you, but it was around the lines of there's not currently much evidence gathered with regard to the levels of trade between the UK countries as we stand just now. So I suppose my question is, what's the baseline that we're going to compare to? Does that make sense?
Reasonably good trade statistics for Scotland and for Wales, and actually for Northern Ireland, as you probably might expect. What we've got less of is the trade statistics for England as a unit in itself. And so that's something that we're working very closely with the ONS on, because that's been identified as something that is post-Brexit, something that, you know, is definitely something that all governments would find useful. And so there is a programme of activity to improve that, and we're certainly involved in that discussion, and so with the analysts from all of the other administrations. And I think that it's quite important that we can do that at a macro level, but also down to sectoral level as well. So I think that's a real, you know, it was something that, as I say, when we did our consultation back in the summer, people were flagging to us as a challenge for us as a new institution. So it's why we've kind of prioritised the business survey and are working so closely with other analytical bodies. Because this is a sort of a first step. I mean, over time, we would be expecting to use this sort of this data to help us track what's happening and identify if there are particular effects being seen, to allow us to dig into those a bit more to see what particular policy interventions may be.
Okay, thank you. This may be a bit of a specific question, but we took evidence in our last meeting about the impact of, or the possible impact of, the subsidy control bill that it could have on agricultural policy in Scotland. So I'm wondering how these kind of things fall into your remit and how you're going to work with other legislation that may be brought in that again impacts on the internal market.
If Jonathan is happy, I'll cover that question as well, because it's a very relevant question to ask at the moment while the Subsidy Control Bill is currently going through the Westminster Parliament. We are very mindful that the PMA has a role in relation to the giving subsidy advice, and that will be separate unit within the CMA that we are starting to design and shape. So it's probably too early for us to say with any detail how the two bits of legislation interact. They are two separate pieces of legislation coming from different places, as it were, but we do see the potential synergies, and I guess there are potentially risks and opportunities. But in terms of the Internal Market Act, there was no specific role set out for the OIM to look at subsidies or consider subsidies. So we're not expecting to do that as part of our normal business.
Okay, thank you. And if I may, just one final question. I'm just interested in you to find out what matrices you'll be using to check whether the UK internal market is working well or efficiently or effectively. Clearly, there's economic business ones, but there are also the well-being, the health, and again, concerns around there with regard to if devolved governments wish to bring in a specific policy because of a specific issue within their area of competence. I'm thinking maybe minimum unit alcohol pricing.
I think, as Rachel has said, I mean, we are very much focused on the economic analysis, and our findings will very much be based on what we understand are the effects on how trade is working and the subsequent potential effects on competition and access to markets and consumer choice. So that will be our focus, but we acknowledge that there are these wider issues in relation to health, environmental objectives, and those are really for governments to consider in the round alongside any advice that we give. But in terms of the health of the internal market, it will be very much that we are focusing on those economic technical issues and not attempting to go beyond the remit that's been envisaged for us and our expertise. And so we're mindful of the need to make sure that's really clear when we do our reports, so that people do not reach conclusions that there is a problem in the holistic understanding of how the four nations are working together. And our focus is really on these economic issues and not those broader well-being issues, as you've described.
Okay, thank you for that. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much. Can I invite Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, convener. And perhaps if I start with Sheila and then move round to the rest of the panel if there's other views. The stated position of the Scottish Government with regard to the Continuity Bill is to align with new EU laws as they are introduced.
if exercised, this could lead to divergence in regulations and create distortions in the UK internal market. Are you concerned about the potential impact of the continuity bill?
So it's probably very important for us to sort of be clear that we're quite a technocratic organisation, and our role is primarily there to advise governments on the effects of particular regulatory divergence on the internal market. We do not have a role in judging what it's appropriate for governments to do in terms of regulatory divergence. What we do note is that there is I think that this remains the policy of all four governments. There is an intention to reach agreements through the Common Frameworks Programme that would allow harmonisation or divergence depending on what governments have agreed. And so that appears to be the appropriate mechanism that governments have put in place for that. Our role is there to support governments, if necessary, with that discussion on common frameworks, or for any matter that doesn't fall within the programme. We can support them with that, but we're not there to sort of reach judgments or decisions.
Thank you for that. Jonathan Scott, do you have any comments?
Just to add one comment to that, I think that one of the things that we can do, we do already, is to shine a light to make sure, and this again goes to the transparency, that the facts are collected together, they're analysed and assessed. The divergence issue is clearly one that the four nations will have to grapple with. I think we can only describe what is happening on the ground and what is the effect, or what is the likely effect, but then those are political decisions. But I wouldn't want you to be in any doubt that we are very conscious of the sensitivity of the role that we have been given, and indeed very conscious that we must not step beyond our remit.
Thank you, panel. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Mr. Scott, could I just ask a supplementary on that? You said it was something the four nations would need to come to agreement on. Now, the Northern Ireland Protocol means that Northern Ireland will stay in step with European regulations, European law. It's a stated wish of the Scottish and the Welsh governments that there would be an implementation of European law going forward, the keeping pace powers, as we call it in Scotland. So in terms of the four nations in this, can the UK government override the wishes of the three other areas in a particular area where there's a problem in agreement? I mean, what happens when there's a stalemate there and it's maybe 3-1 against in terms of implementation of a European law or regulation?
I'm going to let Rachel answer the technicality of that, if I can put it that way. But yes, I mean, you've identified what is, you know, clearly an issue which we are going to have to grapple with, but our role is to report, and then that takes us into either potentially the areas of common frameworks, where I think there has now been real progress, but there will clearly be other areas. So Rachel, perhaps you'd like to elaborate a little.
Thank you, Jonathan. Thank you, convener. I think it's clear, and this was in our written submission, that the Northern Ireland Protocol and the regulated provisions that are there to implement the Northern Ireland Protocol outside our remit as the Office for the Internal Market. So you're absolutely right that there could be divergence where Northern Ireland implements provisions which allow them to stay in line with the EU, and the rest of GB or individual nations in GB choose to diverge from that. That's something that we are likely to be able to look at if we're requested to do so. This is obviously only in the goods area because the Northern Ireland Protocol only applies to goods. So we recognise the challenges associated with the Northern Ireland Protocol. As I say, we're not able to look at it directly, but it's a very important sort of factual context that we'll take into consideration. And to the extent that there is divergence as a result of Northern Ireland choosing to stay or having to stay aligned, then that is something that we may be able to look at in terms of the impact on the UK internal market.
Thank you. Could I invite Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you very much, Convener. I appreciate this is a question directed at Ms. Merrilies. I appreciate that you're not a political body and you're not making political decisions. So please don't think I'm in any way holding you accountable for this. But I just wonder how as a body you're going to navigate the reality that you're implementing an act that doesn't enjoy overall political support in Scotland?
Question, and as I think my colleagues have already said, we're very conscious of these sort of political sensitivities and the environment in which we're operating. I mean, I guess that we have had very constructive conversations at official level across the four nations, actually, and we're working to implement the tasks, that the functions that we've been given by UK government. I think that one of the ways in which we progress is by being as factual and evidence-based as we can. We do have information gathering powers which support us if we need to in gathering information, but we've so far found all four nations comfortable in sharing information with us. This has particularly been on the analytical side, as we were talking about before, our first sort of state of the internal market report that we're putting together at the moment. And I think we just need to continue doing the job that we've been given to do in a relatively technical and straightforward manner. But as you say, the political context is an important one, and one we're certainly not blind to.
Thank you. And a question for Sheila Scobie. Jenny Minto was asking about various examples of the kind of things that might come before you for decision or for you to produce advice on and factual information on. And you mentioned the concept of the barrier to trade. Now, as Jenny Minto pointed out, this is a contentious concept in a number of areas, not least in areas around control of alcohol pricing. But when you mentioned that quite accurately, when you mentioned that all you can do is provide factual advice and it's then up to ministers to take a political decision. Have you any picture of what context or what process UK ministers would use to reach such a decision? Do you have a clearer picture of how that process at their end would actually work?
No, it's a really good question, and it's a question that we've actually been asking government officials, because I think it's a really important part of the jigsaw. I mean, I think there is a requirement in terms of legislation for governments to produce regulatory impact assessments. So there's an obvious tool there or mechanism there. In Scotland, obviously, it's the BREEA, and you know, I think increasingly seeing that these are being used very effectively to set out what the potential economic effects could be on things like competition and on consumers, which I think is a really positive development in Scotland in the last few years. And so you could imagine that you know, if a government has approached us and sought some advice for us on a particular aspect of a regulation or a policy, that this fear may have some sort of effect on the internal market. They could then reflect that in the BREEA and present that to Parliament for your scrutiny. So that's one option. I mean, the other thing is, in the UKIM Act, it does, have an opportunity for an authority, a government, to seek to fulfil
the role of the OIM by using an alternative body. I mean, there's an option for governments to take advice from so many different places. And it may be that there is a particular regulator already within a sector that already has a good amount of information on cross-border effects, or effects on trade or competition. And you know, it may be appropriate for them to deliver advice or for us to work collectively. You know, it's not something that we've explored in depth, but we're very open to suggestions on how to make that work effectively, because clearly the key aim of the OIM's role is to support governments rather than to get in the way of the work that they're trying to do.
I wonder if I could bring Mr. Scott in, who's indicated he wants to come in.
Yes, I just wanted to acknowledge Dr. Allen's question, because it is something we are acutely aware of. And for an unelected body, that is something, again, that you know, carries risk, not just in carrying out the function, but more generally. It's why I'm delighted that we are here today and having an opportunity to have this dialogue. I think it's also reflected in the fact that we have sought to allocate within the organisation some of our most senior resource to it. Again, the fact that I am here today as chairman, I hope, is an acknowledgement of that sensitivity. We're going to have to, you know, play it as it develops, but I can, you know, you can rest assured it is very hard. The issue you have raised, and more generally the risk to us as an organization being between the four nations, is something that is the board is very alive and alert to, and as I say, and I hope you will take some comfort, as I say, not just that the resource we've allocated, but that it's not going to, this activity isn't going to just sort of sit all on its own. It will have the full support of the organisation as it needs it. So Rachel leading the team can draw in from the wider organisation skills.
No, thank you. I'm very, very grateful for that. If I may, just a final brief question for Ms. Merrilies. I think it was yourself who mentioned an ongoing factual context with Northern Ireland and its particular situation, and I appreciate that's not the same situation as Scotland's, but if there is an ongoing policy intention that appears to become consistent in Scotland of keeping pace with European requirements, is there also a factual context that sort of builds up around Scotland that has to become a fact that has to be borne in mind?
Thank you, Dr. Allen. And yes, I suppose what that would mean is that there is more likely to be examples of regulatory divergence in Scotland, potentially, if England and Wales don't choose to follow that path. And that's something that we'll take, you know, as it arrives. But you're absolutely right. It's important for us to be aware.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Mr. Ruskell, please.
A brief follow-up, convener, for the OIM. I'm just thinking about the common frameworks that are being established. One, for example, around sort of waste and circular economy. You've got a mixture of regulations that are in place already, regulations that effectively made the cut that are emerging, like deposit return scheme, and then new regulations that are coming forward that would come into to more fully into the remit of, you know, post-Brexit consideration on EU alignment or otherwise. How do you kind of work with those? I mean, is there effectively a firewall? So when it comes to deposit return scheme, for example, that's something you wouldn't consider because that was previous. Although, you know, regulations can be updated over time. I mean, because the common frameworks are spanning all these three areas. So I'm just interested in where you can actually draw the line, because some of these have got contexts that affect each other as well.
Sorry, I wasn't quite sure who was coming in on this. I'm very happy to kick off, and I may hand over to Sheila for any further detail. It's a good question.
Sorry, it wasn't a great question.
It's a good question, and we've been working very closely with colleagues on the Common Framework side. We understand the importance of Common Frameworks, and we want to make sure that our role sort of adds to the role of the Common Frameworks rather than sort of cuts across it in any sense. But I think your specific question around the timing is an important one. So we only look at regulatory provisions post-transition. And so you're absolutely right. Things that already existed pre-transition would not be relevant regulatory provisions for us to consider. But as they get amended or changed through any kind of process, either legislative or otherwise, they may then come into our scope and our remit. I don't know whether, Sheila, you wanted to add anything on the specifics of those examples.
I don't think so particularly. I think you've pretty much covered what I would have said.
Okay. So specifically on deposit return scheme, if that was amended, that would come within the scope of your remit.
Yes, to the extent that that was done through a new regulatory provision, a legislative amendment, or that would then come into scope. Yes.
Good. Thanks.
Although in general, we do have to look very carefully at scope because there are various exclusions and all sorts of things that need to be assessed on an individual basis. But broadly speaking, if it's a new regulatory provision, then it's something that we would certainly consider.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. Can I invite Mr. Cameron, please?
Thank you, Convener. I was going to ask questions about the protocol and about the common frameworks. And most of those questions have been answered. I suppose just as a kind of final kind of observation, that there's clear tension between the UK Internal Markets Act and common frameworks. And I just wondered if any of the witnesses had any observations on how they in their work might manage that tension. Very rather broad and general question to finish off with. I don't know whoever wants to go first.
Go ahead.
No, Rachel, please come in. Thanks.
Thank you. I think we're very aware of the Common Frameworks process, and indeed, when we took on board our functions, the nations were keen to come and tell us about the Common Frameworks, and we understand that they are a sort of collaborative way of reaching agreement on potential regulatory divergence or indeed potential regulatory alignment. I think what's important to say is it's kind of early days, even for the Common Frameworks process, let alone for the Office of the Internal Market. So we are keen to assist where we can in any sort of issues associated with Common Frameworks and indeed potential exclusions from the UKIM Act, which I know there's a process that's now been articulated by UK government and agreed by the four nations for that. And where we can provide any assistance, we're happy to do so. But it's something that we're working on sort of actively at the moment with our colleagues across the four nations, because it's still quite early in the process to really articulate exactly how we can best help.
Thank you.
Thank you. I think that it's the last of our questions from committee this morning. Is that right, Donald? Do you have another question? Yes? No, you're fine. Thank you so much. I suspect this has been an introductory session with you. The subject area is going to be of interest to the committee going forward as the whole situation develops, and obviously as you start to finalise some of the areas that are in development at the moment. But for this morning, can I thank Mr Scott, Ms Merrilee and Ms Scobie for your attendance at committee this morning. That ends our consideration of this agenda item, and I am now going to close the meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee. Thank you very much for your attendance.